you go. Okay, I'm Frank Hasbani. I'm the organizer of the Data Science and Business Intelligence Society of Atlanta. I'm also the president and CEO of Anova Analytics. Part of that is Anova Institute and the R Boot Camp and the Python Boot Camp. What we do is we're in the education of data science only. So, among you, are you all interested in becoming data scientists? Or maybe find a job in there? Pretty much, something like that? Awesome. Now, today we're not going to make you data scientists. Okay, so if you came with that idea, let's just spell this up front. Okay? Anybody that tells you you're going to become a data scientist in 3 days is, you know, I have some land on the moon, I have some swamp land for you, you know, whatever you want. We set out in Data Science and Business Intelligence Society of Atlanta. We set out 3.5 years ago to basically change that whole notion, that whole idea that somehow you can grab a tool and it's going to turn you into a data scientist. And some of the tools out there, they are even a little more blatant. Hey, look at this. You don't need a data scientist anymore. You can do all you want. No. We're going to talk briefly about this and we're going to show you what it takes. Now, what's the definition of a data scientist? I'll tell you what, if you hear all the rhetoric and all the stuff that is out there, you're a magician, you're a shaman, you can write prescriptions, you can communicate, you're a master mathematician, you're a problem solver, you're an engineer, you're a data analyst, you are all of that. How many people do you know that can do that, all of that? I don't. I've been doing analytics for the last 10 years. I've managed over 80 projects and programs in analytics. I design data that goes in to solve and provide decision support and model predictions. Okay? And I've had a lot of people that I managed in variety of skills, you name it, and have seen them. I've done a lot of these bits and pieces myself. I've done a lot of these sometime because that's what it takes sometime to do it. But according to the definition, I'm not a data scientist yet. That's okay. Because the reality is that whole idea of a data scientist that can do all that doesn't exist. You'll need probably maybe 10-15 years if you keep on studying different domains. Sometimes I even see in descriptions, they want not just the data scientist skills and all of that, but they want HTML and Java and C++ and where? Unless you lie through your teeth on your resume, you're not going to have all that statistics and mathematics and scientific computing. These are completely different disciplines. How many universities do you know that teaches all of that exists in any of the job descriptions? It doesn't exist. Okay, there isn't. Now, having said that, data science is a team sport. It really is. A team, each does a specific thing. And that's what we will teach you, is to do a number of things that at least will make you eligible to get on a team of data science. Either Now, not everybody is going to have the same skills, even when you're finished with, even if you take our boot camps. I'd love for you to all take our boot camps. But even when you finish our data boot camp, chances are your skills probably can be best used in one of those domains, not all of them. Okay? But what you need to do as well is that you need to set yourself on a path to learn and invest in your skills and do some work. And eventually you will get to probably do 2, 3, 4, 5 of those skills. Okay? So, now, having said that, let's get to it. Let's talk about access. How many of you are, at least in your company, they have a data science team or a group of analysts? Okay, good, yeah, a good number. Chances are they are probably somewhere along this path. Probably 90% of the companies, they have already done the OLAP, the BI, the dashboards, the data warehousing, and but all of that is really involves historical data of what happened in the past, and it usually is after the fact. And after the fact, as in what happened last month, what happened yesterday, in a lot of cases, that the data has a latency of probably about 24 hours, right? How many of you have seen any faster than that? More like instant data, streaming data. The tools aren't built for that. The data warehousing path is not built for that. So moving forward, where we are, basically a large number of companies are beginning to touch on this, and so why it didn't happen, and more to the point of what will happen in the future. Or if you have a streaming data, a good example in this, is this transaction a fraud or not? If you're a credit card company and you have transactions coming in at the rate of maybe a million a minute, or a couple of million a minute, or 10 million a minute. Okay. Decisions have to be made fast. How many people do you know that could actually really scan through that, even a huge team? What would it take to make decisions that, yeah, this is erroneous, and this is a scam, and this is not, and this is good? You can't. It won't happen. In data science, you can. It does. To a certain degree of accuracy. Okay? So the idea that companies are beginning to build that, and also, you know, another example, how many of you are at, you know, you have an account with AT&T? Okay, how about Verizon? Okay, so let's take AT&T and beat up on them a little bit. So you're unhappy with AT&T and you decide you want to walk away from AT&T, you want to go to T-Mobile. I've been with T-Mobile. Good company, good rates. Okay. So you hear about it, either directly or through social media or your friends, and you want to switch. When do you want to switch? When your contract is done. Right? So if I was to predict who among you will leave, will churn before you do, and give that data to AT&T, okay, they might come to you with an offer. Right? In fact, they'd be fools not to come to you with an offer, because it costs AT&T about $500 to acquire a plan. What does it cost them to lose you? Zero. Okay. So if they were to come to you and make you an offer that they will give you an additional service worth about $100, $150 maybe, would that be a sweet deal? Would you renew for a year? Probably. Yeah, I guess it depends on how upset are you with their service, or how, you know, is there emotions behind it? Did they cut your service, you know, or you were out of service for 2-3 days at a time when you really needed to finish that exam? Okay. And they didn't care to send anybody until you really complained. Maybe then you say, no, the hell with you, I'm walking. Okay? Verizon has a better service. Okay? So what are we dealing with? What will happen? And even more advanced, if I made you that offer, will you take it or not? So if I was to figure out who among you will churn, and then even more, who will bite, who will accept the offer that AT&T is doing, what are we doing? We're really advanced there. And that's the path that all companies are going to have to build to get there. It's not going to happen next year. Okay. So what you need to do, if you want to take advantage of this, you need to start positioning your skill set somewhere in that, and that's why we have R. Okay. That's why we have R. Or tools like R, Python. Okay. And how many are familiar with R? Great. Have you done anything advanced, like predictions? Okay. So what you've done probably is more like taking an online course? No? Just on your own? You learn on your own? Good.
Online.
Okay. Yeah, you can. Yes, you too, right?
No, I took an online course.
Yeah. Either way, what you'll probably find yourself is that you're not able to put it all together. Yes, you may have learned one thing extensively, well, and real deep, but then you come back and say, okay, well, what now? Right? Mainly, this is, data science is not something like the traditional IT, traditional programming. Not because you can't build an application in R. Yeah, you can if you want. But it wasn't built for that. This is scientific computing, statistical modeling, and scientific computing. Okay. So that's a distinction. Why is that? Okay. Because these tools, and I say these tools as in R, and there are SAS, SPSS. How many people have heard of MATLAB, SPSS, SAS, right? These tools were built not to build applications. Okay? They were built to create models and create predictions, build predictions. Okay? In a traditional IT, what do you try to solve? A function, right? Like a CRM, ETL, moving data from here to there, right? In data science, you're not. You're solving data insight. You're not automating, making an order online, putting it, moving it into the billing so it can be billed and then onto a warehouse so it can be then delivered. Okay. None of that. What you're dealing with, the data itself, data is what you're working with. So the thinking is different. The methods are different. The technology is different. Python is kind of a hybrid. Yes, everybody knows Python because it is a programming language. But there is the scientific computing, the SciKit and other tools in there that kind of made it possible that those as well that start with Python and they think, oh, I can snatch that, you know, just on my own. Hey, I studied Java on my own. Why can't I learn R and Python scientific computing on my own? It's because there are concepts that are not taught in your programming. It's a different way of thinking. And unless somebody show you what these are, or somebody train you on that, universities train you on theories and concepts, great. But how do you tie that into problem solving? Because the first thing you want to do is try and learn how to become a problem solver for data, not processes, not functions, for data. The other thing about R and Python as well now is that there are libraries. These libraries are the bread and butter of what you do. Different processes in data science are built with libraries. And unless you know what these libraries are and how to use them, it's going to be extremely difficult. Okay? Now, it's not impossible, okay? But you can do it. You can do it with somebody else's help or somebody's training to show you, here is this library, this is how you use it, these are the problems you solve with it. Okay? So the challenge for you, yeah, you could take courses online and you get frustrated, and I've heard even very successful Python program, one we had last year, he did a nice presentation about R and Python. And at the end, we had a panel discussion, and in the panel discussion, everybody was saying, okay, why, you know, what frustrates me about a particular language? And he started talking about R and some of the frustrations that he experienced. And then I'm listening to him, and I was in shock. Because his frustration is not because he doesn't know how to do it in R. It's no one showed him how to do it in R. I did that because I learned the right way. Okay. And I could have sat down with him and explained to him how to do it. The point I'm making here is that you will get frustrated if you try and do it on your own. But you can try. Hey, no one can show you. It saves you a lot of time. You learn it the right way, and you can get to build something exciting and solve a problem much faster. Okay, so the other thing in this as well is that there are opportunities in that. So, you see, these are the skills that will be needed on the data science team. Nobody is going to be mastering all of these. Do you know anybody that? How about 50% of that? Maybe 25%? Yeah, so where are the opportunities in that? Basically, number one, really a difficulty for a lot of companies that how do they vet, how do you know the person you're interviewing is a data scientist? Well, here's the quick and dirty. Number one, they are not data scientists themselves. Okay. And even if they were, they aren't knowledgeable in all of this. So how can they interview you and vet you in all of this? They can't. Okay? It's impossible. So there is a lot of problems with that vetting process. Number two, like we said, it's a different technology and the solutions are not IT. So if you're part of IT, great, but in order to kind of go into the data science, your company may have made the mistake and kind of tucked the data science under IT. These strategies have not worked. The other is that the processes. One of the things we train on in the boot camp is what are these processes, the step by step, how to take raw data and what do you do with it. It's based on our experiences, collective experiences that we put together. And so, but there aren't, like, how many are in IT right now? You all know SDLC and other methodologies, right? Or waterfall and, you know, Azure and extreme programming and so on, right? These are well-established methodologies. Whether they are right or wrong, that's not the issue. The issue is that in data science, there aren't yet. It hasn't been written yet. So we are early. Also, data products themselves require unique tools and skills. And this is where you want to, this you can impact, this you can't. Right? This is the one thing that you can't impact, really, is that you learn the tools, you learn the skills, okay? The rest of it is really outside of your control. It's really with your company or the industry, or you can't do anything about it, but you can observe. And if you can observe, then you know where the opportunities are. The last thing is that data science is really a revenue strategic effort. It impacts revenue, like we were talking about, retention, right? Retention, what does it impact? Your market share, your revenue, your costs to acquire a new business, and so on. Okay, so now let's get into where we can help you with the skill set. So let's talk about, so we start with RStudio. How many have used RStudio? You have, and who else? Okay, so for the benefit of everybody, RStudio is a tool that you can use to write code and scripts and run, execute, and see the results of R. So now, let's explain the various pieces of it. Pretty much everything that you will see is also part of the menu. So, okay, so in this panel, the top left-hand side, basically, this is where you write your scripts. Okay. Down here is the console, and the console is basically where the execution of your script. You can see it, and you can see the outcome of it. So if there are errors here, you'll be able to see them. Now, in this particular case, here I ran something called R Markdown. How many people are familiar with R Markdown? Okay. One of the things that is extremely helpful with R is that if you set up a new script, basically, so if we were to go and try and set up a new script, so you click on this here, and it will give you, you know, it's like start new, it's like a new, in the standard applications. What do you want to do? You can do it all markdown, or all notebook, or all script. So let's talk about these briefly, what they are. An R script is just a standard R script that what you need to put into it is pure code. You can insert comments, just like any other language, right? But in there, so for example, let's take a look here. This is what's known as R script. So you can see that, for example, that I put in comments. They are colored in green because they are commented. And other scripts, the actual R scripts, do not need anything before them. Okay. While in the R markdown, it really is a combination. R markdown, how many of you have worked with notebook, Python notebook, or Jupyter? Yeah. So Jupyter notebook actually is a, it came together because of the R markdown. R markdown has been around for a long time, a lot longer. But the idea of it is that you actually, you put your thoughts, your analysis, your ideas in there in the form of text. And then also what you do basically, so this is, it has its own markup coding. It's not that difficult, somewhat similar to HTML. So I will have a heading here, and this is just a text, ideas, analysis, why am I doing this, and so on. And then when I want to run an actual code, this is what's called snippet. Okay. And in a snippet, basically, this is where I put in my script. This is a script I want to run. And if I choose to run this, I can actually see it ran through all of this, and here is my output. So the output gets built into it. So I loaded the empty cars data set. I use these libraries to help. Now these libraries are used later on in it, so they aren't all needed to just run this one or this summary. And then I did a structure and a summary of R, and they are in here. So the structure is this here. It tells me each variable in the data set, whether it's numeric or a factor, such as this. This is a factor, and it has two levels. What? Now, the other thing is that in the summary, what the summary does, it takes each column and it gives me a summary, the minimum, maximum, mean, median, quartiles, first and third quartile. Now, who has a problem understanding what the mean, median, quartile are? I think the majority of people already have done that. This is kind of anybody with a, I guess it's probably even high school level, is it? No. High school level, a lot of people have done more extensive work at universities, right? So basically, it summarizes to me each one of these. And so I can quickly look at all of them and see, you know, so for example, carburetor, 1, 2, 4, 8. Years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, right? That's, that empty car data set was just a collection of specifications of cars. So you can now understand that when we did this, when I executed that snippet alone, it showed me all of the results right in there. Now, here is the nice thing about this. See, this is what we recommend you always do your work, because this is your way of documenting your work, your thought process. How, what did you load? What data did you load? You can even enrich it even with some commentaries. Why? What problem do you want to solve? So you can even start there. I want to predict what mileage a car would have if I have the specifications, the weight, the, you know, etc. That's prediction. So the variables in here are used, mile per gallon. We're going to predict the mile per gallon. We have a cylinder. Horsepower, T-rate, I can't remember what it is. The weight, the quarter of a second, to a quarter of a mile, the number of seconds to reach a quarter of a mile. Anyway, a variety of characteristics. And so what we want to use is that we want to build a predictive model that takes these variables and try and predict the mile per gallon. Okay? So this was my objective. I did this about 3 years ago, so I can, you know, it's kind of difficult to remember all the details. But the point, you see, I can go through this and reread it and remember exactly what I did. Now here's the nice thing about it. When I'm finished with it, I can actually complete it by knitting. Knit-R is another library. What it does, it generates a ready-to-go HTML, a complete HTML that I can see in my browser. I can save it, I can send it to each one of you, and you can look at it in your browser and follow through everything that I did in there with read my explanations. Now in this case, you know, all of my analysis, including I included my code as well. But you can turn on and off these things as well with specific instructions in your script that turns it on and off. So I ran a number of modeling analysis. Now this is happened to be a regression modeling. And I can send it, I can save it and send it to all. Yeah, look at that, I did September 2014, 3 years ago. Open it in a browser, save it, send it to any of you. It does generate an actual HTML automatically, and this is the name of the HTML in the working directory, in your working directory. Okay, so then basically it becomes completely self-contained piece that I can send. Now it doesn't, in this particular case, it doesn't do, you can't use it for modeling. In order to actually predict, okay, you know, I ran the predictions down here on the test, in the test part. Okay, so this, I built the model, and then I run the tests. and it produced a formula for me, so I know now the formula is this. The mile per gallon is or equal to etc., 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 etc. This is the formula that creates the model. Now, in regression, that's the nice thing about regression. Yes, it's not complicated, it's simpler, but also you can debug it, you can relate to, and you can understand what your model does. Okay? And you can take this and actually build it in whatever you want. You can take it to C++ and spreadsheet or anywhere, any language you want. It's simple, it's easy to debug, and it's easy to test. Okay? It's a straightforward. The formula is really simple. Okay. Y equal alpha plus beta x. Or there could be many x's in this case. You know, and the x's are the weight, but the weight is adjusted on a per 1,000 pounds. Okay? And then the Qsec, and whether it's a manual transmission equals one. If it's not manual transmission, it's zero. And anything you're multiplying by zero becomes zero.
What? Would it be possible for you to walk us through the process, like loading the library, loading the data, say?
Not. It's beyond the scope of today. Today, what we want to, this is what we do in the boot camp, not here. But today, what I wanted to show you is that how easy it is to do what you need to do in RStudio and in R. So, especially for those, and I know the majority here have little knowledge of R. I think the focus, as we mentioned, is to get you through the basics. How do you start writing something in R? Okay. But the reason, just give me a second. The reason I'm showing this helps you retain and keep track of what you're doing. Using that R markdown is important because then you can write your own notes however you want to write them. This is your document, your documentation. And you can insert any script that you want and see how it works and comment on it. So this is something that is very useful to you, because chances are you'll probably begin to do scripts here, scripts there, and then lose track of what you did. And you try to what did I do there? Sorry, let me close the door here. Okay. Everybody's following so far? Great. You had a question.
Yeah, you mentioned test scripts that you had. I guess it's a two-part question. Does a testing framework exist in R, and does test-driven development exist in R?
But it is part of the discipline. What I mean by that, the ratios, there are statistical and non-statistical ratios that are produced as part of the building of the model. Okay. And in the process, the actual testing is done automatically, but it produces ratios. The key significance of this, there aren't, like I see sometimes say, unit testing, and this is IT. Great for IT. It's not the same in R, or in statistical, or in data science.
So you're saying the ratio doesn't exist?
It does exist. It's part and parcel of that model. Okay. And it's produced. Part of the model. It contains its own results ratios. such as, for example, accuracy. Confusion matrix. Okay. How many people heard of these terms? Accuracy, confusion matrix, right? Area under the cover, ROC. Okay. These are statistical ratios that produce numbers that are basically the results of the tests of that model. Because part of the process as well is that you take your data, you split it into one, you know, into two or three, depending on how you want to test or the validation that you want to apply, how you validate your model, and then it does that automatically. So in some cases, it splits the data into what's known as K factor, the K factor being how many slices I want to split the data, and then it tests on, it models on this, and then tests on the other one, and then keeps on doing that. So that's part of the process. The challenge is not so much of, in the standard way of doing testing, is not so much that you need to kind of create script for testing. It's all built in. The challenge is actually in understanding what these values are and whether they are good or not. And the other part is that you don't build just one model. You build many models and you compare them, because then you're comparing apples to apples. Yeah?
Is the output that you would typically get in SAS or SPSS something that will show up in the R markdown? Like all of the like R squared?
There are, now that's interesting, because a lot of companies actually are beginning to integrate R into their tool. How they probably built it is that you can, from SAS or SPSS, you can call R, run a script, and it comes back, the results would come back into that. However, I've seen libraries where you can probably call the others, like, you know, we did this a couple of months back just to see how far we can, I guess, we can call one into another. And we went as far as four levels. Now, from one application called R called Scala called Spark, and, you know, and everything was transferred back. So yeah, you could. Okay. But if you're trying to read code of, per se, you have to have the right library. So let's say for Python, if you want to send something to Python, then, you know, the same thing with Scala and Spark. So it's the right library, and then you learn how to use it. And that's the power of languages like R, is that there are 12,000, more than 12,000 libraries in R. Now, this is not a language, let's say, as old as Fortran or C or C++. I mean, R started in the 90s, but it has that rich history of S. How many people heard of S? Yeah. The history of R is S. S was a proprietary language. S stands for statistics, I guess. And the people who developed the S, because AT&T Labs didn't want to make S open source. They went and said, hey, we're going to do this. And so they did it in the 90s, and that's why we have R. Is an open source. But the foundation of R is massive in terms of the universities, the research labs, the scientific community that uses R, especially in DNA, you know, the analysis and the mapping of DNA and genome and all these projects. They use R heavily, and they develop it, and now we have this gift. It really is a gift in terms of what you can do with it. Yeah.
Particular solution, a particular technology suited for these areas.
Libraries. The richness is in the libraries. And the idea, the whole idea is there, is that for you to learn how to find the libraries that will solve your problem for you or can help you solve the problem, learn how to use them, load them up, and educate yourself. It really is a learning trip. It really is. It's not a kind of, you know, I just load the library, run the scripts, and wham, you learn it. Okay? Yeah, but I'm not telling you anything that you haven't seen, especially if the majority of you are in IT. You know this. You need to always update your technology. And R is no different. It's just slightly different approach than your standard. You can learn Python on your own. You know, a lot of people have done so. It's just as hard, probably, compared to, let's say, sitting in and taking the full scale or full stack. But the Python scientific computing is just equally as challenging. It's equally as challenging because also you need to learn Python scientific is not as rich in terms of the libraries. But there is an area in the sidekit that is, I guess, it has been developed farther. But in terms of the breadth of applications, R is richer. The last thing I want to mention is that it really is a preference. You know, are you more comfortable with R or Python? We do boot camps for both. So, okay, we're good? So let's move on. Down to this, when you run the R markdown, you can see that it produced a different scripts or different results, but these are the knitter library execution of all that code that and scripts or comments that I put in there, and it built it into a formatted HTML. So you don't need to know HTML, it's built in, it creates what you want. And again, the purpose of this is that this reproducible work is important, because if you want to show your boss or other team members on what you did, this is your way of showing, and they can take it and reproduce it and validate, yes, what you did is good, or what you did was correct. Certainly there are ways that also to lock that down, because in statistics and in scientific computing, the use of randomization is critical. So sometime let's say you're generating a set of random numbers, we use something called seed. So you set the seed to a specific, you know, number, and then that randomization, it comes out at least so it reproduces exact same results that you use. Everybody knows that, right? Yeah, you've used it. Yeah. So what you're basically doing is that you're ensuring is if you're generating random numbers and I come in and generate different set of random numbers, the results may be slightly different. So, but by giving me the seed, by ensuring that the seed is the seed value that you use is in there. Now I know if I want to change, use different seed, well then I know then my numbers would look different. Okay? So, alright. So basically what happened is that this is the kind of this is the HTML, which you can then send anywhere you want. And like I said, it has the graphs, the explanations, the conclusions you built, or the analysis that you that drove you to do certain things as opposed to alternative approaches. Okay? So, now that we covered this, let's move on to the next. On the top right-hand side, there are a number of tabs there. So let's talk briefly about those. How many people know what an environment is? Okay, an environment is basically it's a set of resources in the computer. Memory, it may be devices, it may be storage space, and a combination of workspace, a reserved or allocated area on the disk, libraries that you loaded in memory, priorities, hierarchies, and so on, that all together, it kind of creates a container. It's like a container. In that container, all the pieces that you put into your environment. And so some of those are basically variables. Remember, we said we loaded the empty cards in there? Well, that's a table. Yeah. And if I click on it, it will show me what's in it. But in there as well, so all the values you may have created, you may have said x equals 10, or and so it will, you will see x in here, or you build a function. Okay. Now, interesting, in R, a function is an object. This is, R is a functional language, so it's treated as an object. So if you create a function, the function would have an abstraction in the environment, and you can then call it from wherever you want to, or right? In addition to that as well, you see all the libraries that I just loaded? These are all the libraries that are in the environment, and I can go into each one of them. This is the knitter that we were talking about that generates that HTML. And these are the components in it. And they may be functions or data sets or any variable or set of variables that are needed. Now, a word of caution here, and that is, I'm showing you this so you will know what to look for if you need to look for. So if you turn around and you call a function that you know it exists in Knitter, but then you gave you an error of some sort, okay, let me look at it. So you go in here and you go down and say, there is no curl here. So yeah, there is hook curl. Where is the C? There's no, okay, so you know that it's not here, okay? Now, what's important, I'm showing you this because you could make a mistake and leave it pointed to that library. If you do, okay, scripts that you may be running in other libraries will begin to give you error. So you need to always go back and reset it to the global environment, and by doing that, basically, you retain that hierarchy that it's supposed to work, the way it's supposed to work, okay? So sometime, what may happen is that you're supposed to load libraries in a special sequence. Okay? And if you happen to load them in the wrong sequence, okay, you may have done a script. Now it doesn't run. Mainly because you could call a script. So let me show you quickly what I mean. So here, I could say, let's say, I want to call the function mean. But let's say, for example, that the mean function is part of is a part of knitter down here, and then it's part of ggplot2. Okay. Now, because I loaded ggplot2 first, the mean assumed now that it needs to use the ggplot2 mean, not the knitter mean. Okay. Now, why is this? It's just the hierarchy. Now, what kind of problem that would get you into? It's possible, and it often always is, that mean in ggplot2 and mean in knitter are not the same functions. They are not equal, they are not equivalent, they don't do the same thing. Now, you say, oh yeah, but mean is mean. I agree. Okay, but what I'm saying is that terminology could have multiple uses. And it could be used in one way in one library and another way in another library. Okay? So I just took mean as an example. You know, mathematically or arithmetically, everybody knows what mean is, right? Yeah, you don't need to. So it should be, generally, it should be exact same function. But it could be another term and if I want to use the one in knitter and bypass the ggplot2, I'd have to do this. Okay. I'll have to do and what this says is that I want the mean from knitter, not the ggplot2. Okay, so anyway, so the point is that you need to maintain that, keep track of that in your own mind as to if you're running into your calling functions that have been implemented in two libraries that you happen to load at the same time or in the same environment. Pay attention to that. Okay, the other thing I want to show you is that from here you can also import a data set. So if you want to import, you don't need to remember the code how to load. So if I go and browse here for a CSV, and I'm sure I have a CSV somewhere. Oh, there. I don't know actually what's in that. So what happened now is that you don't need to know what code to use. It will retrieve and it will preview. It will show you the data, and then you can adjust these parameters here to it. Such as, is it a comma, the delimiter is a comma or a tab or something else.
So did you create a new library with the data, or did you bring the library into an existing, did you bring the data into an existing library?
This is, the CSV is a data file, so it's a data table, okay, that I'm bringing into the environment. I'm loading into the environment, yeah. A library, unless you wrote the library and you want to fool around with it to modify it, you don't want to change libraries. Yeah, and But this, like, you know, it would show as a table, like the empty cars. Yeah, this is, I hope it doesn't take a long time, but I wanted to show you so you know what to do. Okay, while we're doing this, any